Hi, everybody. Next up, we have Nikolay Marinov. He travels a lot, and also in his spare time, he likes to experiment with different hardware and software things, which make his daily life easier. Let's give it up for him.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Is the sound okay? Okay. So first, hello everybody. I'm Nikolay Marinov, and today I'm going to talk you about my experience with Raspberry Pi in the car. What I have done, how I'm using it, and some future ideas that I want to implement in the future. Here you can find me at this email addresses, and in this GitHub account you can find all the source code that is made for that presentation and for extending the car capabilities using a Raspberry Pi. You can also scan my V-card for easier access. You have that opportunity also in the end of the lecture. A quick introduction of myself. I have 14 years of experience as a server-side developer, mainly on Linux with C and C++. At the moment, I'm working in Cyan on an automatic trading platform. And in my spare time, I really like to experiment with different kind of software and hardware systems that are making my life easier. Besides that, I also like traveling a lot with my fiance and seeing a lot of new places and explore them. So the condition of my car and how it behaves, what the features that I have in the car are very important to me. First of all, let's see how many of you know what's a Raspberry Pi. Okay, a lot of people. How many people are using Raspberry Pi daily? Okay, not so many. okay, so a quick information about Raspberry Pi for the ones that didn't know about this piece of hardware. Raspberry Pi is a single board computer in the size of the credit card. Here's my Raspberry Pi that I'm using in my car. And on which I'm making all these extensions and things that you'll see later in the presentation. Raspberry Pi is unique for two reasons. First is that it's a fully capable computer, so it has a lot of interfaces as you see in the board. You have four USB ports, Ethernet port, specific ports for display and camera built by the Raspberry Pi. You have HDMI output and audio output. It's ARM-based processor with integrated GPU in it. And one of the main features is this GPIO pins, general purpose input-output pins, to which you can connect external hardware. For example, some kind of sensors from which you can get data. Or, for example, control another hardware that you connect to these pins by issuing some signals on them using some APIs available for the Raspberry Pi. The second thing is that this piece of hardware is really cheap. This model is the latest model that was released 2016, and its price is around 32 euros, so everybody can buy it and really experiment with this piece of hardware for a very small amount of money. Why choose to use the Raspberry Pi in the car? Initially, I had some problems with some fault errors that my onboard computer fired, and I needed to clear them, so I started using some Android software from my phone, but that software was not so good. When I needed to clear some errors, this piece of software was clearing all the errors in the onboard computer, as well as the learned data that the computer learned through the time. And after every such clearance of the system, the car needed some time to learn some of the statistics that was collected. Then I tried to search for an alternative and found an open source and free solution made by some smart guys that actually reversed and engineered the proprietary protocol of my car and implemented that knowledge in that piece of software, which was very good because it was not only diagnostic software, it has some features that are allowing you to just some of the car parameters and actually change how your car is behaving. For example, it can change how the what are the idling RPMs of the car. For example, the normal RPMs when the car is idle is around 700, but you can change, for example, that value to 1000, so your car will always be on 1000. I started using that software from my laptop, and it was good, but the setup with the laptop and the need for bringing the laptop always with me when I was traveling on long distance was somehow inconvenient. So I started thinking, okay, this is a free and open source software, I probably can do something. At least this time I had this board in my home and I was using it as a media center device. So I thought, okay, I probably can buy some kind of display for it. It's running Linux, so the FreeSSM software which I used was available. I can fork it and change his layout. So the software will be able to run on this small device and I can have this small device like that always with me when I'm traveling and in the car. So I've just made these changes and put that device in one of the pockets in the car and I was traveling with better pleasure because knowing that always when I'm on the way I can just plug in this little device, see if I of course had some problems, see what is the problem and eventually clear some of the errors of the car. After some time this device was sleeping in my car, something started bothering me. I started thinking I have a fully capable computer and I have an open and free software for it, which I already extended. Maybe I can extend that software a little bit more and make some plugins on top of that software and add new features to my car. And in that moment, I get this big idea to actually change my standard dashboard of the car, which is like that. It's not very interactive. I have a little and display that was showing only limited statistics to something like that. Integrated system on board that can be easily extended and it is free and open source so everyone can benefit from it. And eventually some people also will make additional improvements so we can create some kind of community and extend that system. First of all, let's go deeper and let me show you some demonstrations of what I've done. And first, let me show you what's the FreeSSM software and how I was using it initially with the laptop setup in my car. By the definition of the people that made the software, this is free and easy to use diagnostic adjustment tool for Subaru vehicles. It provides access to the engine and transmission control units, which is very important because the generic tools available, which are using OBD2 connections, typically are not having access to specific units in the car computer. And here, I don't know how. It's not viewing. It's not very good. Let me try to start that directly. Okay, is it visible enough? Okay, yes. So this is my laptop in the car. The car is started. I don't know how what you're seeing, but now I'm going to start the FreeSSM software, which is the original one that I've used. You can see that there are interfaces and buttons for the engine, the transmission, the ABC cruise control, and the air conditioning. Here I'm loading the engine control unit. Here you can see some information about the car type. Here the error codes of the engine and the cruise control. And here are some historic codes that are recorded by the computer. These buttons here are navigating to different parts of the engine of the engine control unit. Here, actually, you can add some type of properties that you want to watch in your car. For example, there are two different type of options. There are measurement blocks, which are outputting values in some range, and there are Boolean values. They are called switches, which are just on and off. So if you add some of these properties, measurement boxes or switches, and we start here, click the start button, we'll see their values and how their values are changing at the moment while the car is running. For example, you can see here I'm changing the front lights, whether they're switched or not. And this last sensor here, maybe because of the reflection, is not good. It's not visible enough, very good. But here, the value is changing from on and off. So you can actually monitor these values easily. But that was not very good. You need to bring the laptop first, and this interface and the values here are very small. So when you are driving, for example, it's very hard to monitor these values. That was not good. You need to have the car parked and monitor these values statically, but sometimes you need to monitor values when you are driving to see some kind of problems. This is the transmission control unit, and I think this is enough introduction of the FreeSSM software. Okay, let's close this. Oops. Okay. So, the FreeSSM software was not a generic OBD2 scan tool. It was using the proprietary Subaru protocol that was reverse engineered, and to use it you need a special cable, which is a low level cable that on one side is with OBD2 connector and is just a voltage level converter, and on the other side you can have a serial port connector or USB that is simulating a serial port, so you can receive the data from the car computer. So this will be the demo for the FreeSSM that I modified, and I added a new set of layouts in it so it can be usable through the Raspberry Pi in the car. This was my second step. And I will again need to... to start the video directly, because for some reason it's not showing very good. So this is how the Raspbian distribution is loading on the Raspberry Pi. And here you can see how I'll start the modified version of the FreeSSM software and how I'm using it from that small device. I've designed the new interfaces in such a way that they are better viewed in a mobile device and small screen, so the buttons are bigger and the whole interface was extending depending on the screen size. That was some kind of restriction in the original software because its layout was a little static. So it was not usable in this small screen. Here you can see again the engine control unit. You can see some errors in my cruise control, maybe because I've played a little bit with it. And the interface here in the modules, for example, in the engine unit, the transmission and all such interfaces inside the software, I've made them tapped interfaces. So you can access these big screens from the rear FreeSM in the small screen, and from the vertical tabs you can select the different kind of actions that you can make. For example, again, you can select the measurement blocks, add some measurements, and monitor them in a better way in your car. Still, the values are small, and it was not easier to see them when you're driving. Which was a little bit of restriction again. But it was more convenient having this small device. Just left it inside the car in some pocket and use it when you need it. So you can see here, the values are moving again. These are the engine speeds, how much RPMs are engine now running. And you have also adjustment. Here you can change some of the car properties, for example, the idling speed. You have some system tests. You can test some of your components of the car. And that's it. I was happy at that moment. Using that kind of device, it was enough. But after some time, as I told you, I started thinking how to extend it. To implement this new kind of layouts, I actually decided to not replace the old layouts, but make them conditionally compiling, so you can build both the original version and the old version. And because the project was Qt-based, I needed to add conditional compiling not only in the source code, where there are some hard-coded values, but also in the interfaces. And here we are coming to the interesting part. When I started using this device and then started thinking how to extend it, I'll start another video which will show one of the plugins that I'm using. It's the rear camera plugin. So from one script that I created, I'll start both the FreeSSM software by providing to it a configuration file which is having some of these measurement blocks and switches pre-configured, so the software will start automatically monitoring them. And after that, this script will start a Python plugin that will listen for events that the FreeSSM software is publishing. In this video, I'll show you how I connected the rear gear. When I select the rear gear here, that plugin is listening for the rear gear signal that I've selected the rear gear, and I installed a rear camera, so you can see the rear camera and how you can look behind your car. So, for example, when you're parking, that can help you to avoid some obstacles, or I'm not a very good driver, so that was helpful for me. Here you can see in the interface how this value is changing again when I'm changing the rear gear. I developed that plugin using a Python and a Pygame for a Python. to do that, actually I added some additional modifications to the FreeSCM software and added a TCP server in it. So the FreeSCM software was listening for connections from outside listeners, and when someone connected to that, we're using a TCP socket, the FreeSCM software was starting to publish the data that was currently monitored. The second change was to make the FreeSCM software starting directly with some pre-configured parameters that needs to be monitored. Now I'll show another interesting plugin. That was the dashboard plugin. For that plugin, now it's modern to have a dashboard camera recorders in your cars. So for example, you can record your trip, or for example, if you have some accident on the road, you can have some proof that you are not wrong for that accident, or just you want to record some driver that is driving not safe on the road. I remapped these four buttons here on my wheel, which are for the cruise control, and I'm not using them too often. So as a proof, as a concept, that was good enough. I mapped them in such way that when I press one of the buttons, it will take a front picture, not now. The first time I was not able to press the button correctly, but now when I press it, here the display will display taking a front picture from the front camera, and here's the front picture actually taken from the front camera. When I press another button, you see now a picture from the back camera, and the other two buttons are making videos, which is very good. I tried it several times when I was on the road and was very happy because I was able to just control control when I want to record some videos, but don't need to touch on the interface and just using the buttons on my wheel. And here, when I press that button, that will take front video. I'll do a little driving so you can see how this video is looking. Taken from the front camera. Okay, some people passing. It looks good. As a proof of concept, it looks good. One restriction that I had is this small display here. It was very cheap, and its refresh rate was very bad. So for a real usage, I'm planning actually to substitute it with a better display with a good refresh rate that will connect either on the specific display port that the Raspberry Pi is having or on the HDMI connector. So I can have a better view of the rear camera, for example, or better view of the next plugin that I'll show you, because currently, as you saw in the previous plugin video, looking at the back camera on that monitor was having a lot of lag. And here is how the rear camera will look on a normal display that is not so cheap. And you can see what's really behind your car when you are parking, for example. And for better view, probably you need 180 degree camera, which is installed maybe near your rear plate. For that demo, I have installed the camera on the topmost point of the rear window. And finally, let me start the last demonstration and finish with the videos for today. That was the statistics plugin. You already saw that looking at the values that you want to monitor is not so easy because the numbers were small, and it was inconvenient. If you want to check some values when you are driving, it was not easy, so I just added this additional plugin that is displaying some of the values in a better way, so you can look at them even when you are driving. This is again starting FreeSSM with a pre-configured file with these values that I want to monitor, and starting additional plugin that is connecting to the TCP server in the FreeSSM, and started listening for incoming data from the FreeSSM. Again, the monitor here is not good. Maybe it's not very visible here, it's a little darker, but there is a lag between the actual values and the values that are displayed here on the monitor. That's something that I really need to improve by adding a different kind of monitor. And that's all. I have there is a little bit more. I wanted to show you also how easy it is to actually develop such a plugin having that TCP server in the FreeSSM software. Something that I forgot. Also, in the last plugin, I also recorded all the values that we get from the FreeSSM and save them to a CSV file. So eventually, you can import them in another kind of software or use machine learning on them to find some interesting things. For example, if you are a safe driver or not, just analyze that data that is collected. And here on the next two slides, I'll show you how easy it is to implement such a plugin and extend the car features. And that example will show you how to, for example, we know that in Bulgaria in the winter, the front lights need to be always turned on. But not every car has this device that is beeping you when the front lights are not turned on. So this is the simple plugin configuration file that is passed to the FreeSSM. It's saying to the FreeSSM, when you start to monitor the switch in the engine unit with number 15. And that number corresponds to the front light switch, which is on and off, depending on the state of the front lights. Actually, this is how the plugin looks like. It's not very, very visible here, but I'll try to explain it. Very simple. This is the importing part of the Python script, some definitions where the script needs to connect. This is the part where it connects to the TCP server that is started in the FreeSSM software. And this is the part where it starts listening for data, do some manipulation of the received data, so you can extract the current value of the switch that we are monitoring. And this is actually the best part, when this value is off, so our front lights are not turned on. We are generating system sound with frequency 440. That's a little beep sound that will notify you that your front lights are not turned at the moment, so you can turn them on. Here are some future ideas that I have actually. For example, adding parktronic sensors and displaying the information from them, again on the Raspberry Pi display in the car. Maybe a camera sensor that would detect a drop rains on the front windshield and turn on the wipers directly using this GPIO from the Raspberry Pi. I don't know how this will happen, but I probably will search and find a way. Maybe a driving style recognizer, are you a safe driver or not, or maybe your state in the days you're a little bit nervous and driving not so safe, so this kind of plugin will notify you to drive more safer. Car plates recognizer, it's interesting thing. I thought of building some kind of image model and load it in the Raspberry Pi so it will be able to detect the car plates of every car that passes you, so you can have a little record what cars you met in the road. That's very interesting. Monitoring driver condition, there was some statistics that the drivers which are after 50, 55 years old, are more have a higher chance having a heart attack when are driving. So, for example, you can monitor the driver condition, adding some additional sensors to the Raspberry Pi and notify you that your health condition at the moment when you are driving is not very good, so you can stop, take a break, and continue your trip when you are in better condition. Finally, that was really final. I want to give some credits. They're for the FreeSM developers that developed that great software for Subaru vehicles. It's free and open source, as I already told you, so everyone can clone it, fork it, and modify it. The OpenFest organizers for bringing us together and making that event possible and sharing ideas. Science for giving me the equipment for that presentation and supporting me. And Slides Carnival, from where I get these presentation slides. So thank you very much. And now is the time if you have any questions.
So you've said about FreeSSM. Are there other alternatives? As far as I've learned, that FreeSSM is especially for Subaru, right?
Mm-hmm, yes.
So are there other alternatives that are for like general purposes, more models or more cars?
I don't know, because actually I haven't searched. I search only for my vehicle. But actually, yesterday I just tried to search for something like that. I saw that there are some implementations also for the VAG group. But as I understand, they was not so good as the FreeSM. There were some initial implementations. The guys also reverse engineered the VAG group protocol and was able to connect to the onboard computer directly without using higher level protocol like Elm 327 and such things. So there's some success there, but I don't know if there's something as a final product that you can use for free for other type of vehicles.
Okay, I have one more question. So have you considered, sending the data that you collect from the Raspberry somewhere on a server or
yes,
a database?
Yes, cloud-based.
How would you approach that problem?
Because the newest Raspberry Pi board is having built-in Wi-Fi.
But where are you going to get the Wi-Fi from?
Probably one possibility is using your mobile phone connection. If you have a good plan, probably you are not going to send so much data.
Because I've thought about a similar idea. If I've had this question, and I've thought of plugging in a SIM card. Would it be more convenient than the Wi-Fi?
It's possible. I already saw some implementations as a modules for Raspberry Pi where you can use this GPIO port. It's a head. I think last year we had a presentation here about the Raspberry heads. So you can just plug in that head on the GPIO pins and have a SIM card module into your Raspberry Pi that you can insert SIM card and have a data connection. I already saw some projects in the internet using Raspberry Pi as a regular cell phone, so I think it's possible.
Thanks.
Thank you too.
Okay, one question from my side as well.
Okay.
So when you use reverse engineered protocols for your car and dealing with software, is there any chance that you break the entire module?
Yes, I think there is a chance, always there is a chance, and the developers of the FreeSM, and I'm as a developer of the plugins and all the extensions, there's a special condition saying that nobody is responsible for any damages on the car or the engine or anything when you're using that kind of software. You're using it on your own risk. So no guarantees. Only the legal solutions from the dealers are.
That's fine. So Can you tell me what would be the potential damage as price for your car first? And second, is there any option to revert the software to default or let's say make a backup copy of?
I know there are some options. You can have your echo flushed by the dealers. I don't know actually what can be damaged. That's something that I forgot to mention in the lecture, but when you're implementing such things, and when I'm implementing such things, I'm very careful not to send anything to the onboard computer that I don't know what this kind of information will do and what will be the damage. So, as you saw, all my plugins are just collecting some data and using external hardware to extend the car features, not trying to mess with the echo itself.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you. Okay. Hi.
Okay. So I'm really sorry for. I will be a little bit retro thinking, but one very important thing when you talk about automotive development at all is fail safety.
Yes.
And all that you've done is really great, analyzing data, and the idea with analyzing your driving manners and stuff like this is really awesome. But my general request to you and to everybody who's going to be trying something on their own car is when you try to interact with whatever it is, even if it's the wipers, the front wipers or whatever, the lights, keep in mind that when somebody is designing the original system, it's a simple thing and a lot of fail safety around it.
Exactly.
And if you skip that part, even the wipers could be very dangerous.
Exactly.
So keep on going, research more. That's really great, and you present that everybody can do this. But when everybody does this, keep in mind that there is fail safety.
Safety first, because
definitely, yeah.
Car is a little plain soul. True. I agree. Any questions? More?
If there are no any other questions, let's thank Nikolay.
Okay. Thank you.